גבירותיי ורבותיי, לפני שאני מקדים כמה מילים על האורחת השלישית שלנו מבולגריה, פרופסור בויקה דונבסקה, אני רוצה רק להזכיר לאור הדברים שאמרו פה שלוש עובדות קצרות במשפט אחד בלבד. א', שנדע שבוריס שץ היה הרוח החיה בהקמת בצלאל, גם כמוזיאון, גם כבית ספר לאומנות. שתיים, הוא רוח החיה, אבל לא הכסף, לא היה לו. הוא נפגש עם הרצל ב-1904, או שנה לפני זה, והוא נפטר אחר כך הרצל זמן קצר אחרי הפגישה, והרצל עודד אותו להקים את המפעל. העובדה השנייה, שהקונגרס הציוני ב-1905, הראשון אחרי פטירת הרצל, הקציב כסף להקמת בית הספר בצלאל. העובדה השלישית, שבפעילותו הציונית, בוריס שץ אכן גם מושפע ממה שעשה בבולגריה בעזרתו של פרדיננד המלך, מפני שהוא ייסד במסגרת בית הספר לאומנות בצלאל גם בתי מלאכה לאומנות, לאו דווקא אומנות, לאומנות. והדבר הזה היה בבולגריה ביחס לתעשיית השטיחים. העסיקו שם במוזיאון שהקימו בוריס שץ ומרביצ'קה ואחרים בתי מלאכה כדי לסייע לנשים מהכפר לעבוד כאשר אי אפשר לעבוד בחורף בשדה בגלל השלגים. וכאן הוא הקים תעשייה כזאת שאני הקטן זוכר בגיל 4, זאת אומרת שנת 41, 42, בטרם ההגליה לפרובינציה, אני זוכר טבקרה, זאת אומרת קופסת טבק שיוצרה פה, ובחרדת קודש הדודים ואבא שלי הסתכלו על זה ונגעו ופתחו ושמו סיגריות עם גמלים, אבל גם עם הכותל המערבי ועם מגדל דוד. אז אלה דברים שאסור לשכוח, אלה פקים קטנים אבל פקים חשובים. כן, אז ככה, לגבי הגברת שעכשיו אני רוצה להזמין, הגברת בויקה דונבסקה, אני רוצה להגיד מה שהיא היסטוריונית, פרופסור להיסטוריה של אומנות, וגם סגן הרקטור באוניברסיטה לאומנויות בסופיה. בנוסף על כך, כשעברתי על אין סוף הפובליקציות שלה, הפרסומים, ואין סוף התסריטים שהיא עושה בטלוויזיה הבולגרית הלאומית, נתקלתי גם בכך שהיא בין 95 ל-98 הייתה מרצה להיסטוריה של אומנות במה שקרוי האקדמיה החופשית לאומנות על שם ז'יל פסקן בסופיה. אז ז'יל פסקן, ממי שהוא ממוצא בולגרי צריך לדעת, יהודי בולגרי צריך לדעת, שמו האמיתי היה יעקב פינקס, והוא בא מהעיר וידין, ובעיר וידין משפחת פינקס הייתה בעלת ספינות מאוד עשירה המשפחה. מדוע? מפני שוידין היא נוחתת על הים, סליחה, כן, על הים השחור, נכון? או שאני טועה, על הדנובה. על הדנובה ורחודונבה, ומשם הדרך הימית לאוסטרו-הונגריה ולמרכז אירופה. אותו פינקס הגיע לפריס כרושם רישומים וכצייר, והוא זכה לתהילה גדולה מאוד. מודליאני כותב עליו כמה דברים מאוד חמים בכתביו מאותה תקופה, וגם סופו היה כסופו של מודליאני, אם אינני טועה, הוא מת מאוד צעיר, אינני זוכר עכשיו אם זה היה מוות עצמי או משהו אחר, אבל הוא מת בשנות ה-40 המוקדמות שלו, והיו לו אחים שנותרו והגיעו גם לארץ בתור ציונים. עכשיו, ולכן גם לגברת בויקה דונבסקה יש מגע ישיר עם העם היהודי. גברת דונבסקה, גוספוז'ה דונבסקה, госпожа Донецка, госпожа професор Бойка Донецка, е също и хаджия. Тя ми припомни, че вчера вече са били всички трите гостенки, кой шалоша орхот, שהיו מבולגריה, שיש לנו מבולגריה, היו גם בקבר הקדוש, הספיקו להגיע בירושלים לקבר הקדוש, ובבולגריה לכאלה קוראים חג'יקי, כמו חג'יה, זאת אומרת כמו חג' בטורקית, מי שהולך למכה, ככה נוצרי הוא יהודי שבא לירושלים, הוא חג'. моля госпожа професор Хаджийка.
Благодаря на господин Папо за това изключително атрактивно представяне, което направи.
Не му дали мар Папо ла цега кулках атрактивит.
И за това, че с лекота очерта една нова съвместна тема, тази посветена на Юлиас Пинкас.
Веше гам у Натан Кав ле איזשהו נושא חדש, המחקר של יוליוס פינקס.
Уважаеми дами и господа, темата на моя доклад е посветена на българският период на Бори Шац.
ההרצאה שלי תהיה בנושא של התקופה הבולגרית של בורי שץ.
Този период и от гледна точка на изследователите, и от гледната точка на самият автор е един от най-ползотворните в цялото му творчество.
התקופה הזאת גם מנקודת המבט של בורי שץ עצמו וגם מבחינת מנקודת המבט של ההיסטוריונים, זו התקופה אולי הכי פוריה בחיים שלו.
Той обаче е и най-благодарен от гледна точка на изследователя.
אבל התקופה הזאת מאוד מאוד טובה דווקא לחוקרים.
Защото очакваме там да излязат все още нови данни, нови факти и много нови интерпретации.
מכיוון שעדיין יש ציפייה שאנחנו נמצא עוד חומרים ועוד תיעוד לא מוכר עד עכשיו.
През последните години, благодарение на дейността на госпожа Иванка Гезенко, бяха извадени много нови документи, писма, много нови факти за живота на Бори Шац у нас.
בשנים האחרונות, בעיקר הודות הפעילות של גברת גזנקו, יצאו תעודות חדשות לא מוכרות מהארכיונים ששופכות אור חדש על החיים של בורי שץ.
ние обаче все още сме длъжници на този автор.
אנחנו עדיין חייבים לבורי שץ.
Все още неговото творчество не е получило окончателната си интерпретация и аз се надявам, че този доклад е една малка стъпка в тази посока.
הפעילות שלו עדיין לא מצא את המחקר הראוי לו לגמרי, ואני מקווה שההרצאה שלי תעשה איזשהו צד קטן לכיוון הזה.
За изготвянето му аз съм си послужила с материали от архива на Националната художествена академия в София, някои от които все още не показвани.
להכנת ההרצאה השתמשתי בחומרים בעיקר מהאקדמיה,
אקדמיה סופיה.
אקדמיה לאומנות בסופיה, שחלק מהם עדיין לא ראו אור.
Затова ние имаме и своите общи тези с госпожа Гезенко, имаме и различен тип интерпретация на творческите постижения.
ולכן יש לנו דברים משותפים במחקר שלנו עם גברת גזנקו, אבל יש גם לנו איזשהו קווים שונים במחקר שלנו על בורי שץ.
И тъй като за всички е очевидно, че мой английски не е достатъчно добър, за да представя своите тези, позволете ми да използвам любезната помощ на господин Чурапчиев.
ובגלל שאני קצת מתרגשת כשאני צריכה להרצות באנגלית, אז פשוט הרשיתי לעצמי לבקש עזרה. אז אני ממשיך. ובגלל שפה יש יותר קשר הפעם, היא כמובן תהיה פה ותסייע בהחלפת הנכונה, החלפה הנכונה של השקופיות. The formation of the secular culture immediately after the liberation of Bulgaria from the Ottoman rule takes place in a dynamic social and public environment whose specificity directly affect the organization and manifestation of the artistic life. At this... Okay. פשוט התבקשתי לקרוא כמה שיותר מהר בגלל שהפיגור גדול. It's good for Bob, no? Okay. אז אני אעשה משהו באמצע. At this stage, the state already has new political order, new urban living standards are formed, and of course, new cultural strategy. Psychologically speaking, Bulgarian society is ready to make the difficult transition between two epochs, the late revival and the modern history. The striving for restoration of Bulgarian nationality and state is accompanied by an eagerness to equalize it as soon as possible with Europe to gain European self-esteem and culture. In this regard, the transition to secular art and professional artistic education of European design is perceived as the primary and most important task. Europeanization, however, proves to be hardly a unique and easy process. New idea bearers during the first two decades after the liberation became foreign artists, among whom are standing out the names of Otto Horeshi, Ivan Mrkvichka, Yaroslav Veshin, Esther Slepian, and Boris Schatz, who bended a decade of his life with Bulgaria. In Boris Schatz's biography, there are several circumstances that render a strong formative influence on his work. He was born in Vilnius, Lithuania, in 1867, in the family of pious parents. Soon the tendency towards the art points him in the direction of the Vilnius Drawing School. Despite the difficulties of learning Russian language, Schatz definitely wants to become a European-style artist. This is how the two leading lines of influence are shaped by the Jewish tradition and Russian culture, permanently connected in his consciousness. Around 1887-1888, he began to attend a fine arts course in Warsaw. In 1889, he went to Paris, where he joined the Academy of Fine Arts in the painting class of Professor Comon. In Paris, his dream of studying sculpture with his compatriot Mark Antokolsky and later his assistant came true. Antokolsky Mordechai Matveyevich is the first sculptor of Jewish origin who gains worldwide reputation. His example represents an extraordinary phenomenon in the intellectual life of the Jews and has a historical significance for the development of sculpture of that time. As a Semite, deist. Antokolsky expresses in his works his philosophical ideas of the celebration of the spirit and the reason over the power and materialism above all. The presence of Boris Schatz in this elite, for its time, cultural circles of writers, artists, actors, and critics between 1819 and 1894 has important projections for his future development. In 1895, Schatz arrives in Bulgaria at the invitation of Prince Ferdinand, who sees his work in Paris. Almost immediately, he joins the Society of Fame of Artists and Public Figures, Ivan Mrkvichka, Anton Mitov, Konstantin Velichkov, and Dr. Ivan Shishmanov, who initiated the idea of creating a higher educational institution of arts in Bulgaria. In 1896, when the State Drawing School, nowadays National Academy of Art, opens its doors, the first teachers' council consisted of three lecturers: Ivan Mrkvichka, director and lecturer of painting; Anton Mitov, lecturer of art history and perspective; and Boris Schatz, who taught modeling. These council members, playfully called by their compatriots the Holy Trinity, have been crucial for the artistic life in this period. They defined the directions of the education and presented the alumni of the school in all committees, councils, competitions, and juries for world exhibitions. According to the law of the establishment of the State Drawing School, it aims to prepare, first, artists in the visual arts, second, lecturers of drawing, drafting, and calligraphy for the high schools, and third, painters in the various branches of the art industry: icon painting, carving, decorative art, ceramics, goldsmith trade, weaving industries, etc. Thus, on a program basis, the State Drawing School unified the specifics of three different types of professional school: secondary art schools, academies, and industrial schools. In fact, Schatz's presence in the academic history was fitted to a relatively short period of time, from 1st of October 1896 till 1st of April 1900, when he taught modeling. This is, however, precisely the period when the academic strategy is created. Schatz turns out to be well prepared for the mission that he is taking, to introduce the European-style academic education in the field of sculpture. He creates the first original programs that have been taught on for a long time at the school. Even before his discovery, Schatz taught modeling in his preparatory school and at Esther Slepian School. Although they are classical by nature, these programs create the conditions for a high level of modern learning. The official report of the State Drawing School from 1907 states that in the general preparatory courses with duration of 3 years, the modeling training involves a sequential modeling of ornaments, masks, and bas-reliefs on plaster models, and their casting in plaster as well as plaster casting of live figure from nature. In the next degree, the special course with a duration of 2 years has already a specialized sculpture training. It includes the following schools: sculpture, wood sculpture, metallic articles, ceramic, and other articles. In each school are taught a wide range of broad professional and general disciplines. In the sculpture school are taught modeling of clay figures and wax from nature, composition of monuments, memorials and decorative statues, medals, sculpture materials, equipment, galvanoplasty, casting for plaster, cement, terracotta, etc. In the wood sculpture school, a taught figure and ornament modeling from nature and drawings, composition of furniture, iconostasis and frames, carving for iconostasis, furniture, etc., incrustation, gold plating of wooden articles, casting in different ways, concept of styles, ornaments and wooden articles. In the school for metallic articles, the special subjects are composition for all art industrial articles of metal, church vessels, ornaments, decoration and filigree articles, molding and preparation of different systems of molds and galvanoplasty, casting of zinc articles, nickeling, gold plating, silver plating, etc., concepts of styles, sculpture ornaments, and kinds of artistic and industrial articles of metal, metal making and chasing. In the school for ceramic articles, the connection for folk with the folk tradition is particularly emphasized. Here are molded from clay and wax figures, ornaments, flowers, animals, and various ceramic articles from nature and drawings. They imitate styles and ceramic articles predominantly from Eastern and Bulgarian styles. Studied are casting and modeling techniques in stone, plaster, cement, and terracotta. Styles in ceramic and decorative art. Even from this exact enumeration becomes clear that by creating the programs, Schatz follows the organizational structure of the European schools, adapting it to traditional Bulgarian styles and arts. The programs demonstrate his broad awareness, high professionalism and culture. His best-known disciple, sculptor Andrei Nikolov, notes that Schatz had mastered with extraordinary ease each sculptural technique while freely using both stone and wood, metal and ivory. In order for us to fully appreciate his actual contribution, it should be mentioned that so far the easel sculpture has no traditions of its own in Bulgarian art. During the Middle Ages and the Renaissance, it was exclusively connected with the wood carving and the carved iconostasis. After the liberation, the monumental forms of the commemorative sculpture are predominantly developed, many of which were created by a model project abroad and were realized in the spirit of classicism. It is therefore hardly surprising to say that it was in fact, Schatz who created the first easel sculptures in the new Bulgarian art and who introduced in sculpture a whole generation of talented authors. However, Schatz's significance for the rise of the Bulgarian sculpture in the early 20th century is far from being limited to his role as a teacher of young talents. Along with his work at the drawing school, he executes the personal orders of Prince Ferdinand and the former orders of the palace. When the Emperor Nikolai II is to accede to the Russian throne in 1896, the Bulgarian artist decided to give him a big coronation album as a sign of gratitude for the liberation of Bulgaria. Schatz is the author of the metal body of the album, and he has to perform the impressive task within 3 months. He manages to do this with exceptional creative creativity and fantasy. The album represent a Metallica volume, 220 cubic meters high, weighing 700 kilos, cast from bronze in a silver alloy. More than 20 pictures from the most famous Bulgarian artists, Mrkvić, Komitov, etc., are stored in it. The album itself is supported by the figures of two peasants, a Bulgarian and a Macedonian, that were modeled by Schatz. Thus, the work makes an ideological message as well, as Macedonia remains beyond the boundaries of the Principality Bulgaria. It is striking that for a very short period, Schatz manages to get to know the Bulgarian tradition and give it an artistic translation. His characters are extremely figurative and ethnographically realistic, and the sculptural volumes are covered with stylized ornaments drawn from the Bulgarian medieval manuscripts. The album is cast in the famous Barbedien bronze foundry in Paris, a benchmark for quality of metalworking. The work is shown for several days in the large hall of the National Assembly in Sofia, and after that it is sent to the day of coronation of Nicholas II. The next significant order of Prince Ferdinand is the portrait of his late wife Maria Luisa, who died in 1899. The parade portrait presenting the princess as the heiress of the medieval Bulgarian royal tradition is performed by Ivan Mrkvička, and the elaborately designed plastic frame is ordered to Boris Schatz. He skillfully combines Bulgarian decorative elements with 20 reliefs depicting representatives of different ethnic groups in the country: Bulgarian, Jews, Turks, Greeks, and Roma. Grieving angels and Saint Cecilia, patron of the princess, are presented as well. Maria Luisa's portrait is included in the World Exhibition in Paris in 1900, where Mrkvička and Schatz win gold medals. Having mastered the technique of the miniature in relief, Schatz is also considered as one of the first masters of medals and plaques in Bulgaria. Schatz teaches searches of the typical Bulgarian Okay, and etc. Zania Leche Lasov. The beginning of the century marks a new stage in his in Boris Schatz's artistic density. In 1901, he takes part in the first international competition held in Bulgaria for the monument of the Tsar Liberator in Sofia, and we already discussed that. In 1905, Schatz finally leaves Bulgaria and heads for his next mission, which his fate will be linked with from that moment on: the opening of the Bezalel School of Art in Jerusalem. The dream of the revival of Israel and of Jewish culture and art became the next cause of his active and noble man. Historically, it turns out that the years spent in Bulgaria were actually one of the most fruitful period for him. Despite the difficulties encountered, Schatz has always preserved a good memory of Bulgaria, which, according to his son Bezalel, considers his second homeland. For this reason, his family organizes his retrospective exhibition in 1934 in Sofia, donating some of the works to the National Gallery. When Schatz dies in 1932, the Bulgarian art has already passed a long way of development, of change of the ideas and conflict between trends and generations. The academism of the realistic school, which has earned the artist partiality, has long ago been rejected, but his personality remains among the most prominent representatives of the new Bulgarian sculpture.